What's your disagreement with the Gnostics?
Well, I take it that you use the term Gnostic in its true historical sense. So Gnosticism was, so to speak, in antiquity, the counter-religion to Christ. So there were Gnostic gurus all over the ancient world.
They saw themselves as Christian, though, correct or no?
Well, I don't know their psychology, and I don't even want to delve into it. There are certain characteristics of Gnosticism that one needs to bear in mind. First of all, they were antagonists to the death of Christianity. They despised Christianity, whether they, you know, manifested that or didn't, that was integral. In other words, if you will, they belonged to Satan. They were Satan's men. And secondly, they had an idea of a flight into higher worlds. There was all kinds of teachings and all kinds of methods of attaining that higher flight. And so their idea was that the summum bonum of life is to get out of this world. They rejected it as utterly evil and in every way disgusting, revolting, and the thing to do is to leave it, get out of here. Mm-hmm. And actually, the way they conceived their higher world, their summum bonum, is really secondary. The important thing about the Gnostics is that everything pertaining to this world and all the good things, they regarded as the very opposite. They had disgust for it. For example, a Gnostic is a natural, what is the word? He likes to dishonor everything that the followers of God regard as sacred. So he would love to take, say, a holy Bible and throw it into the sewer. He wants to destroy. And to him, everything here in this world is evil, and he has a sort of a dream castle in the sky, which is his goal, his heaven, his eschaton. That's, in a few words, the main characteristic of the ancient Gnostics. And they came in all different colors and guises. And what I have said is, so to speak, the common denominator. They differed very, in fact, one of the early Christians said, every day, every one of them invents something new. So you can't define Gnosticism by giving it, so to speak, a credo, because they had all different beliefs and theories. The common denominator, which is the only way of defining them, was this idea that everything here, everything that we normally hold as sacred or beautiful or holy, is somehow trash. They spit on it. They are, you see,
Did they follow other books of the Bible that we don't consider canon?
I don't know that much about it. For example, I've read the so-called unauthoritative gospels the Gospel.
Thomas, Mary.
Yes, I've read some of these.
What do you make of them? You don't like them?
Well, there are good things in it, but there's quite a bit that you can learn from it. But the mere fact that the Church Fathers have not included this in the official teachings of our Lord makes me instinctively keep away from it. Why read something that does not have the imprimatur of Christianity when we have these wonderful books that does carry the imprimatur? So firstly, we have Scripture, Holy Scripture, the Old and New Testament. And secondly, we have the writings of the saintly teachers of the faith. We have a Saint Augustine, we have a Saint Maximus the Confessor. We have boundless literature of high rank. Of course, Scripture is one thing, everything else is another. This division is absolute. But the point I'm trying to make, we have such wonderful Scripture, why read something that is in any way questionable, like the Gospel of Thomas? Because who knows, there may be innuendos there that are not really orthodox. And there's no need also to go beyond Scripture and the approved writing of the saints and the recognized teachers of the Church. So, I'm sorry, we were talking about the Gnostics, right. So what I want to say now is this. It turns out that with the end of antiquity, the Middle Ages, and then the beginning of the modern age, a very interesting thing happened. Gnosticism morphed. It changed its outer form and turned into what I call neo-Gnosticism. And the difference between the ancient Gnosticism and the neo-Gnosticism is this. I said that an integral part of Gnosticism is the idea of this journey into higher worlds. The problem that the Gnostics faced with the dawn of the modern age is that we no longer accept any higher worlds. So the problem was very, very drastic. How can you fly into higher worlds when there are no more higher worlds to fly into? This was the problem. And by golly, they solved it. And do you know how they solved it? It's really interesting and ingenious. This all comes from Satan, and Satan is very ingenious. No question about that. So the neo-Gnostic way of solving this problem that there are no more higher worlds to fly into is very simple. They said the higher world is futuristic. In other words, this world itself is being turned into the higher world. So the higher world became futuristic.
Like worshiping technology or thinking that...
Yes, exactly. And as a matter of fact, who is the neo-Gnostic prophet of modern times? Thea de Chardin. There's no question about it. Thea de Chardin is, so to speak, the great Gnostic guru of the present age. This is also why he had tremendous power, because the devil has power. Let no one be in doubt about that. He has great power. In fact, the power of Satan is so great that unless we humans, avail ourselves of the sacred means given to us by God, we have no chance of withstanding that power.
If you enjoyed this Toe clipping, then the full video is linked in the description. You should also sign up for Toe Mail, which is again in the description and the pinned comment. You'll receive immediate access to all exclusive updates from the Theories of Everything podcast. It also helps me communicate directly with the core Toe community. You'll also receive my top 10 toes. Think of it as the intellectual version of Quentin Tarantino's obsession.